The Big Scottish Football Podcast with Stephen Mill and Ewen Cameron.
Hello and welcome to the Big Scottish Football Podcast. It is episode 58, which in bingo terms, Ewen Cameron, is
58 eggs on a plate.
Not a bad shout. It does rhyme this one, which is good. It's not that though.
Is it anything to do with food?
No.
Plates?
No.
Oh, it's great.
No, it's 58. Make them wait. And then the crowd shout back, or the players shout back, choo choo, Thomas. Apparently. Choo-choo. Anyway, I'm Stephen Mill. He's Ewen Cameron. He still can't cook rice. We have had so many comments about rice over the last few weeks. And mostly everyone just saying, for the love of God, just buy a rice cooker. Please just buy a rice cooker.
But do rice cookers work?
Yes. That's why they are a thing.
Yeah, I know that rice cookers are a thing. Like a coffee machine is a thing.
People make millions of pounds for rice cookers, so they wouldn't if they didn't work, no one would buy them.
I've got a coffee machine in the house, right? It's still nowhere near as good as the coffee you get for Starbucks, for Costa.
Really?
Or for Cafe Nero. It's nowhere near as good. I've got a coffee machine in the house.
Is it a rubbish coffee machine?
No, it's one of those Nespresso ones. It's really good. You've got the wee pods. I've got chocolate flavour. I've got all types of...
And it's not as good as the Starbucks one or Costa one. The
point you're making here is that a rice maker is brilliant.
I don't have a rice maker because I'm a normal person and I can cook rice like a normal person. But I know that rice cookers are a thing.
Yeah, like I said, a coffee machine is a thing, but it doesn't necessarily mean you're going to get good rice from the machine or good coffee from the machine. That's the point that I'm making. I still will suggest and I will still say that rice is difficult to make. And I know there were a shitload of people last week who were messaging the podcast on YouTube and on Twitter and on Facebook about how I can't cook rice. But there was also a lot of people out there who also agreed with me that rice is a difficult thing to make. Let's just leave it at that.
Okay.
Some things we're good at, some things we're bad at. I'm not so good at rice, but I'm good at other things.
I'm hesitant to ask what you are good at.
Well, I'm very good at macaroni.
Right.
Macaroni cheese with burnt bits of bacon, tiny bits of burnt bits of bacon.
Don't you mean like sort of well done bacon as opposed to burnt bacon?
But crispy. I mean proper crispy
bacon.
I don't mean burnt like set it on fire.
Right, we're not going down this road because it'll take ages.
But what I would suggest when it comes to making a macaroni is that you have the burnt bits of bacon in it. Also, it works superbly pepperoni.
Great.
Slices of pepperoni mixed in with the bacon, you fry it up and then you throw it into the macaroni with your cheese sauce and then you put some mild cheddar cheese on top of the macaroni and then you stick it under the grill and you grill it for 15 minutes until the cheese on top goes hard and crusty.
Yeah.
And then you scoop it all out and it's
crusty.
Amazing.
I mean, you use all the nice words when it comes to cooking. Do you like your food burnt and crusty? Don't you mean crispy?
No,
would be a much. I like it when it's crusty. Nobody's ever said that about food. How was your macaroni and cheese? Oh, it was crusty. Nobody's ever said that at all. So, a food critic, you are not good at.
No.
Let's get to some other comments. Let's go to Ben's 19. Instead of reading out these comments, Stephen, you should read out the comments section on the Clyde One Super Scoreboard episode that you and Cameron hosted. It was a quiet night at the office for you and Cameron last Thursday night. We'll probably get to that a wee bit later on. There's Jordan Spears. Do you remember him?
Who?
Jordan Spears. So he was the guy who invited you to join his pro clubs team on FC24.
Oh, God, aye.
And you didn't do it. You said you would get in touch with him. So anyway, he's now rescinded his invitation. Basically, it's gone. It's gone.
Oh, but I'm really, I'm shit hot at FC24. I mean, I genuinely am. I'm in Division 5 Arrivals of Ultimate Team.
You met Jordan Spears on Thursday as well.
Was he the guy on the train?
Yes.
That tapped me on the shoulder.
Who said...
Love the podcast.
He was like, I was raging after the Rangers game and, you know, I'm so annoyed that he didn't join me on my pro club's team, FC24, but I've just seen him on, I'm writing this on the train, edit, just walked past him, shat it, said I enjoyed the podcast and walked off the train. Was only kidding. Love yous.
He did. He tapped me on the shoulders as he was getting off the train. I think he was getting off the train either. Was it Croy or Falkirk? One of the two.
Right. So that was Jordan then.
That was Jordan. What a small world.
Yes, exactly.
And he just like, mate, love your podcast. I went, cheers, bud. And then he walked on. So he shat it from having a go at me for not getting involved in his PlayStation
game. And just
game.
Said, I love the podcast. Yes. Yeah, exactly. Hello to Christopher Todd, 7696, who says, Stephen Mill, even though Potter and Rodgers are completely comparable on every level, you can't compare them because I love Celtic and Brendan Rodgers hates Rangers. So that sort of falls on from the Todd Cantwell chat from last week in the podcast, which was great fun. T Treble BP says, is this a serious show?
No,
it's not. It's not a serious show.
We're football fans who like to talk football.
Yes.
And we have an opinion like you have an opinion. The only difference between you and I is that we have a microphone and we just put it out there for you to listen to.
Yeah, and listen, you don't have to agree with us all the time.
No, and it's not rocket science. It's not like we're saving lives or anything. We're just here talking about the game that we love.
Mm-hmm. Hello to Craig Rooney, 8945, who says, a couple of points from the show last week. I did not know what a voyeur meant, so thanks for that, Stephen. And apparently, Producer John, you did a Roadrunner impression at 1:17:07. I know into the bit last week's podcast.
I know the bit they're talking about.
Apparently you did a nice Roadrunner impression. You did a bit of that, but it was like an unintentional. I don't think you meant it, John. Exactly. There's a proper one there. Right, what else have we got here? Lots of people saying about your movie choices.
The Watcher.
Yes, exactly. It was mixed.
Listen, 9 times out of 10, my movie recommendations are well loved and liked, but Watcher is, I mean, it's got an 86% positive rating on Rotten Tomatoes. I also gave it a very positive rating, and I've got a mixed reaction to my movie recommendation.
Well,
Watcher.
Andy Mack, 2994, says, Ewan's movie reviews might as well be called Ewan's movie spoilers. Don't need to bother watching the first hour and a half of The Watcher now after that absolute tirade from Ewan. I'll give him his due. Talk to Me was class.
Yeah, Talk to Me
you
was
watch
good.
Cocaine Bear on Saturday night?
We're not going to talk about that.
I watched it on Saturday night on your recommendation and I switched it off.
No, you didn't watch it on my recommendation. I was watching it. I said, this is what I'm doing tonight. I didn't recommend it.
Right.
I said, I'm watching Cocaine Bear to then review it on the podcast, but I'm not even going to review because it's that bad.
Lots of people asking about your bracelets as well, and if you got them free with your bag.
Cheeky gets. There's nothing wrong with my bracelets. These are my holiday bracelets.
On the Cantwell stuff, lots of feedback on that. Tree Monkey 0073 says, absolutely right, Cantwell farts to the sea if he dives about the pitch, acting the hard man to appease the support. Now, can I just clarify, I didn't say Todd Cantwell wasn't a good player. I actually literally said that last week. I just said that he hasn't done it in a Rangers jersey. And then when I actually explained that to people, they were like, oh yeah, I actually agree with you.
Yeah.
So there we are. But I mean, that's what happens when producer John writes the headlines.
I'm not going to be doing a movie review this week.
No, you're not.
Right,
no.
Because we're not going to bother talking about Cocaine Bear. It was awful. But what I would like to do is talk about this. It's back.
Oh, Big Brother.
Why?
Because I watched about it last night and the Scottish lassie, I know you're going to talk about her. That's why Scotland can't have nice things. Like, it was horrendous.
Right,
it was so bad.
Right, I'm going to tell you something, right, that not a lot of people know. I love Big Brother, right? I'm addicted to Big Brother. And when it first burst onto our screens, I couldn't get enough of it. I would watch them sleeping through the night when they used to do the live broadcast on Channel 4. It'd move on to E4 and I'd watch the housemates sleeping.
I remember that.
Right, that's how addicted I was to it. And I was working on the Real Radio Football Forum with Ruffy from 2002 right through until 2010. And during that time, and when I would get home from working on the football phone, and the first thing I would do is watch Big Brother while I was eating my tea. So I fell in love with the football phone. I fell in love with Big Brother thanks to the football phone. And I was asked if I would...
John, do we have a jingle to play? I think
this is the Real Football Phone-In with Ewan Cameron and Alan Ruff. Call now on 0845 100 2101.
Me. So I was on the football phone. Can you kill that music now because it's doing my head in? So I was on the football phone, right?
Mm-hmm.
And somebody dared me to go and stand in the queue at the SCCC to try and become a housemate for Big Brother.
Mm-hmm.
And because I loved the show that much, I thought, yeah, I'll give it a go for a laugh. Got myself in the queue, SCCC Glasgow. went through, spoke to a few people, producer type people and all that, got through the first stage, got through the second stage, got a phone call, can you come down to Manchester? I was down at the final 50 to be on Big Brother.
And what year was this?
Was it 2005?
It was getting a bit rubbish by that time.
It was like, I was a couple of years into the football phone-in, but they wanted me to go down to Manchester.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, final 50. I'd made the final 50 and I shat it.
Did you?
And the reason I shat it is because I was having a very successful career on the Real Radio football phone-in.
Mm-hmm.
I'd taken a football phone-in show to another level.
Right.
I was doing things differently, and I was just the best at what I was doing.
Right.
And then I couldn't run the risk of jeopardizing that.
You couldn't. No,
and not because at all. See, when you go into Big Brother house, you're not in control of what might be said.
Yeah, and you say a lot of mental things.
Yeah,
so,
and front pages and all that stuff. Yeah. So I couldn't have naked pictures of me appearing on the front pages of newspapers and playing stupid games when I was being a serious football phone-in journalist.
My mate went into Big Brother, do you know that? Well,
who's that?
Eugene.
Who? Eugene!
He was second. He became second in the Big Brother 6. He got beaten off the Geordie boy.
Aye.
Was he not a radio engineer?
He was.
Was he not the one that ate the chilies and he couldn't handle it?
But he probably was, Eugene. Yeah, he was a bit sensitive that way. But yeah, he was a good lad, Eugene. He used to throw televisions off cliffs for a hobby.
There you are, that could have been you, Ewan.
So anyway, Big Brother is up and running. It was a launch night last night, so it's on every night on ITV2 at 9 p.m. There are 14 housemates, and I actually think the characters are fantastic. And there is one Scots person in it.
Yeah.
Her name is Olivia, and we've got a clip.
Hi, I'm Olivia. I'm a dancer, and I'm from the best place in Scotland, Glasgow. I'm very patriotic. Like, if you play the bagpipes, best believe that's the one time I'll probably cry. I live with my mum, my dad, and my two younger sisters, and I am the princess of the house.
Well, probably not, because she's already up for eviction.
Right.
She went into the house, she was in for an hour, and Jenkin nominated her for eviction.
Well.
Jenkin's the guy who likes to wear Magnum shirts.
Well, based on that clip, I would be agreeing with Jenkin.
Okay, and will you be watching with me?
I won't be. I'll quickly tell you that I was nearly on a TV show twice. Right,
go on.
I was nearly on Pointless.
I want to do that show.
So
how about you do it?
I went for an audition with my mate to the Old Jury's Inn on Jamaica Street in Glasgow.
Yeah,
won the audition.
Uh huh.
Because the question was name a gladiator.
Right.
From the TV show Gladiators.
Uh-huh.
I said Ace, and that was a pointless answer.
Oh, brilliant!
Was it Ace or Ice? It was one of them
Ace,
anyway.
Yeah.
And we never got a call back. I don't know why.
Why?
Don't know. Secondly, I nearly was on Come Dine With Me. And the reason I didn't do Come Dine With Me, I was picked to go and Come Dine With Me.
So you were actually on it?
Mm-hmm. And then they were like, oh, you'll need to take a week off your work. And I was like, but I don't want to waste a week's holiday going on Come Dine With Me.
So you knocked it back?
So I knocked it back. So, because what they don't tell you about Come Dine With Me is they don't actually finish until like 2 and 3 in the morning. Like, it takes forever.
Okay.
Like people listening, people watching, telly takes forever.
Oh, it does. That's why I prefer radio to
unless
telly.
Unless you're doing live telly, like telly takes ages.
Yeah, agreed.
So, because they have to film everything about 15 million times. So,
what would you have cooked? Would you have done macaroni with burnt bits of bacon?
I was doing a Mexican sort of theme. Is what I was doing. I was doing like tacos.
Would you have provided the entertainment and had the hats and everything, the maracas and all that?
I booked a mariachi band. Right, anyway, in terms of the football, we've got something a wee bit different this week. It's an international week, so there's a wee bit less chat on the other end.
Yes.
We will talk about Scotland, obviously, a wee bit later on. But we have a special guest coming into the studio, and it is Ewan Cameron.
Yeah, it's Billy Davies. Billy Davies, who's a former Motherwell, Preston, Derby and Nottingham Forest manager. Now, we talked to him about the Rangers job, the Hearts job and Rottweilers. Yes, we did. But here is what he said about potentially taking the Rangers job after I had spoke to his representative. He said to me that he has been in contact with the chief executive, James Bisgrove, and there's an offer on the table that Billy Davies will come into Rangers and you will offer your services for free to manage a club until the end of the season. Is that true?
if Lee wants to have a long shelf life, then he better not keep continuing down this road. Let me tell you something. Look, I'm available. I'm just along the road. It's a great club and a club that I admire greatly. I certainly would go into the end of the season and help them. I've got no doubt that if that offer ever came along, then that's something that I would look at.
You're offering your services for free. Billy Davies, with all your successes in the past and the type of manager that you are, that wants to bring back the fear factor and the drive to Rangers that you think they're lacking, that you think you can bring, you're willing to do that for free?
Ewan, as I said to you, if he wants to have a long shelf life, right, then he better be careful.
I know that he's made that offer.
Uh-huh.
Right? He told me he's made that offer, and the messages have been going backwards and forwards between him and James Bisgrove. So that offer is definitely on the table. And you're happy to do that. And you think you can do a job. Because you wouldn't be sat here speaking to me today and Lee wouldn't be telling me what he told me last night if you didn't believe and he didn't believe that you could turn that club around.
Well, that's the thing. You've got to look at things very carefully and then make decisions from there. I've got no doubt that that challenge would be a very exciting challenge. And as I said to you before, I'd be delighted to help him to the end of the season if that was the case. But what Lee never told you is he never told you that he's actually offered to pay me 15 grand a week.
Out of his own pocket, yeah. Yeah. The full chat with Billy Davies you will hear later on this week. Just make sure you subscribe, obviously, in all the usual podcast places, and we'll stick it up on YouTube as well. But some really interesting stuff from Billy Davies. 9 years out the game has been. We asked him about that, what he's been up to, if there's been any sort of close calls in terms of getting jobs and stuff like that as well.
The story around Hearts is fascinating. Nearly got the job there in 2017. He's looking trim, he's looking fit. His family issues, which he kind of touches on during the podcast, are now behind him as well. So he's now fully focused 100% on wanting to get back into football and do what he does best. And I've always said that Billy Davies is a proper football manager. And I think he'll do a great job wherever he turns up. But it's good to see him back.
Yeah, absolutely. It was a good chat. So you'll hear that a little bit later on this week. Let's crack on with the football, though. And since you mentioned Hearts, let's start with the Edinburgh Derby on Saturday.
Do we have to?
Yes, we do, because it was Hearts 2, Hibs 2, 83 seconds between Hibs being 2-0 down and 2-2. Hearts were so comfortable in that game for such a long period of time. And then it all just fell to bits in less than 90 seconds.
It fell to bits because of a couple of defensive errors, particularly the second one. The criticism that I would aim at Stephen Naismith, and this is a criticism that's shared by many, not just me, is his substitutions were very strange. We're 2-0 up and we're coasting. And Steve Cowan, who was at the game for us for the big Saturday football show, had said that Alex Lowry had run his race after 60 minutes. So they decided to take Lowry off, who was outstanding for Hearts on the day, a creative force, and was causing Hibs no end of problems. I mean, he was in there. He was in their face. He was causing issues.
Hit the post as well.
He was finding the gaps in between the lines, creating chances. Excellent performance. He comes off after he's run his race, and I genuinely thought that they would bring on Grant, who was unlucky to miss out on Saturday, been playing well, and he's another creative guy who's also a goal threat. But they decided to go with Beningame, who isn't yet, for me, up to speed, because he was off for a full season because of injury. They made the mistake of bringing him in to play Rosenberg, and they hooked him at half-time. Here we are in an Edinburgh derby after 60 minutes on a heavy pitch in the heavy rain. And he brings on a defensive midfielder in Beningame. That instantly says to Hibs, we're going to try and sit in here and just hold on for a 2-0. So I think he got his substitution wrong. And I think that gave Hibs a boost. And then Hibs get the goal from Johan, the first one, which is unlucky. There's a rebound of
Slightly correct you there. They took off Alex Lowry and brought on Beningame when it was 2-0.
That's what I said. That's my point. It's the point I was making.
Oh, sorry. Apologies. Yeah.
Well, yes. Apology accepted. And that's the point I was making. Bring on an attacking player, like for like player, but I think by going with the defensive player, it gave Hibs a boost. I really do. And then shortly after that, there's a problem in the penalty area for Hearts. There's a pass, I think it's from Doige. It rebounds off Sibic's heel in right in front of Johan, and he slams it in the back of net, 2-1. Right, Hearts regroup. I can don't lose another goal now. And then what is it, 80 seconds later?
83 seconds.
The cross comes in. I don't know what Sibic's doing at the near post.
It was a really nice layoff, actually.
It was a great layoff.
It was really good. Really good forward play.
And then Johan slams that into the back of net, and it's 2-2. And then from that point, Hibs looked the more likely and the more dangerous to go in and win the game.
Yeah.
So it was really disappointing. I was really angry and upset, which is why I didn't tweet about it. Because see, when you're 2-0 up at Tynecastle against your rivals, you should be seeing that out.
Would you have taken 2-2 before the game?
Before the game, I would have taken a draw because I think Hibs are a good side. I knew there'd be goals in the game because of Hibs' attacking threat, and Hearts have obviously got a good attacking threat as well. So yeah, I would have taken a score draw at the start of the game. Obviously, I want you to win the game, but just based on current form and how Hearts had been playing and how Hibs had been playing, I would have been happy with a draw. But when you're 2-0 up, you have to. It felt like a defeat to me. Well, you saw me in the studio.
Mm-hmm.
I was gutted. I was absolutely gutted by that result.
So Hearts remain in fourth place, Hibs in seventh place, and Nick Montgomery still unbeaten as Hibs manager. So 2-2 finished in the Edinburgh Derby. You had a bit of a rant about it not being on the TV on Saturday.
Hearts-Hibs, yeah. Not being on the telly. Should have been on the telly. Look at it. What a game it was. It was end-to-end, piss and rain, heavy pitch. The fans... It was electric. The place was bouncing, and Hearts give the former school end to the Hibs fans. Absolutely amazing. And seeing Hibs scored that equaliser and the fans were bouncing about as much as I hated every second of it. That's what football's about. Football's about the spectacle. It's about the atmosphere. And seeing when you don't have that for an Old Firm game, it's just horrible. And there's Hearts. They've just given Celtic 500 tickets for the game at Tynecastle against Celtic on a Wednesday night. I would like to see the Celtic fans, the Rangers fans, get more tickets than that, just to add to the spectacle and to the atmosphere. And I think we miss out on that.
How many tickets do Hearts get when they go to Parkhead?
Yeah, that's a good point. But I think we get 800 when we go to Rangers, is it? I think it's just under 1,000
mm-hmm.
in the corner. We're stuck under the corner underneath the screen. But that's by the by, because I don't think we would fill a stand at Ibrox or Parkhead. So I think... But I'm not saying that we give Rangers or Celtic the full stand, but I do think they could split the stand and give them at least 1,600 tickets.
Okay. In terms of the TV thing, I know we've covered this on this podcast a lot of times.
But that's why I want to talk about it again, because it's not going to change.
I think it's worth reiterating.
But it's not changing, Stephen.
I know it's not changing, but I think it's worth reiterating that the reason that Sky don't pick games like that is because they might have to show Celtic... or Rangers
going to Tynecastle
later on in the season, and that gets them bigger figures. And the reason that there are only four television games per stadium, that's the clubs. That's not on Sky.
No,
that's on the clubs.
Yeah, but Sky have made it abundantly clear that they're going to show Celtic and Rangers every week.
Yes,
that's where the money is, and that's where the viewers are. But the clubs have signed a shitty deal.
Yeah, they have.
And they're to blame for that.
Yeah.
Not Sky. Sky are going, oh, you dancer. Thank you very much.
So let's move on to Celtic on Saturday. Celtic 3, Kilmarnock 1, Hatate, Palmer and Taylor. So Cameron Carter-Vickers makes his return. Palmer getting the nod as well. So 3-3 from him. Some questions over, obviously, Kilmarnock's defending for a couple of goals. We'll get into VAR, WTF mm-hmm. in just 3 seconds, the offside call as well. But, you know, we were talking before the game, highly unlikely that Kilmarnock were going to beat Celtic 2 times in a row.
I thought Kilmarnock were good on Saturday.
But they played pretty well, yeah.
Great chances.
Again, it's been, you know, you look at the table, Celtic have won 7 matches, they've drawn 1, lost 0, they've only dropped 2 points this season, but you still think they're not playing particularly well. And even Brendan Rodgers is saying there's still a lot of work to do here.
Hatate was good, though.
Hatate's goal was excellent.
Not just his goal, but his overall performance was outstanding. He looks like he's back to his best after his injury. I thought Kilmarnock, though... And this will be a worry for Brendan Rodgers. They created some good chances. I can't remember a club that went to Celtic Park and created some half-decent chances as well. And their goal was a good goal. It was a really well-worked goal down the left to begin with, and then they switch it to the right and Watson pops up and scores through the legs of Joe Hart. But again, Celtic not at their very best win, and they win with goals. Mm-hmm. They scored three goals and it could have been more. So, yeah, Celtic have won this league. I mean, there's no doubt about it. I mean,
they're 7 points clear now of both Rangers and St. Mirren.
But having said that, though, can I just point out Celtic, when they return from the international break, they're away to Hearts and they're away to Hibs in the space of a week. They go to Edinburgh twice in the space of a week. Two really tough games, that. See, if they come out of that with, say, a minimum of 4 points, that's it. I mean, I think it's already done.
They do have Atletico Madrid to play in amongst that as well. So yes, it's a tough run of games for them.
It is.
So yeah, Celtic 3, Kilmarnock 1 on Saturday. Let's go to Livingston, Motherwell 2-0. Anderson, Bruce Anderson, in terms of strikers out with the bigger teams, I think Bruce Anderson should be playing at a bigger club. I think he looks very, very good every time I see him. He scores lots of goals.
Who's he replacing anywhere? Who's he replacing? He's not replacing Shankland. He's not replacing Johan or Martin Boyle or Vente or Lafondra. He could replace Dessers, I guess.
I'm just putting out there. I think he's a pretty decent player.
A squad player. I'm not sure he's your first choice. He's good at Livingston, but you'd be good on that plastic pitch.
I don't think I would be, to be honest with you.
I think that plastic pitch makes a huge difference.
He also scores away from home as well.
Yeah, I know. But listen, Livingston deserved a win.
Yeah, I guess.
But I also think they were helped by the sending off.
Yes, and we'll get to that in VRWTF as well. Four losses on the spin for Motherwell, so they need to buck up their ideas if they're finishing third, although they're only 5 points behind third at the moment. So 2-0 to Livingston that finished on Saturday. Let's move on to the games yesterday. Start with the early one. St Mirren 0, Rangers 3. Again, we'll get to the red card and the penalty in VRWTF. But a welcome win for Rangers. Needed because it had been a rotten week up until that point. They'll be glad it was fairly comfortable in the end.
In the end, but they struggled up until that second goal, even when they had the advantage of St Mirren going down to 10 men. They just needed a win. And it didn't matter how it came about, they just had to get the 3 points. And they got the 3 points. Tavernier again steps up to do the business.
Great second goal.
The second goal's just
107 goals he's got for Rangers. Now, James Tavernier gets a really, really bad rap from a lot of Rangers fans.
He does.
He does seem to be a scapegoat at times. But 107 goals. I know a lot of them are for set pieces as well and penalties.
Yeah.
But I think James Tavernier's been a good player for Rangers.
Good servant.
And still continues to pop up with important goals like he did yesterday.
Yeah, great goal. That third goal was unreal. Can I also just say Seema?
Yeah, I was going to say, so that's
six and six.
Yeah, so I think 7 goals overall.
Overall, that's a good return.
Do we now take him out the shocking pile of signings?
I think you have to.
And put him in the good pile?
He's in the good pile.
He's in the good pile.
He's in there with Raskin and Cantwell. And Butland.
Okay.
He's in the good pile. The rest are all pish.
Okay. Aberdeen 0, St Johnstone 0. There was... it started with a red card for St Johnstone. It was overturned.
It was overturned, which we'll get to.
Aberdeen will be kicking themselves because they should have won on Thursday night. And then yesterday, they huffed and puffed.
See when you go to Ibrox and you beat Rangers 3-1, you have to follow that up with a victory against the bottom club. And that's the problem with the other teams out with the Celtic and Rangers.
They're not consistent.
They're not consistent enough. They're just... I mean, I genuinely thought Aberdeen were going to win that. I thought it was going to be 3-0 minimum. Easy street, 3 points. And they struggled. 0-0. And St John's had more shots on goal than them. So, yeah.
St Johnstone, by the way, still struggling. Still without a win this season. Still bottom of the table. Stephen McLean lives to fight another day.
He does.
As St Johnstone manager, he's obviously not going to be punted out.
And it's really tight at the bottom of the table anyway.
It is. It's really tight from, 11th upwards. There's only 3 points between 11th and 5th.
And up until Rangers winning yesterday, Rangers were closer to relegation than Celtic.
Yeah. Okay, right. So St Johnstone, bottom of the table, Celtic top of the table, Rangers up to second after that win against St Mirren, and obviously Dundee versus Ross County was off. Dunfermline Arbroath was off in the Championship as well due to a waterlogged pitch. Elsewhere, Ayr United get their second win in three matches, beating Airdrie by 2-1. Big Dunk still unbeaten as Inverness manager, 0-0 against Partick Thistle on Saturday.
Free scoring Partick Thistle.
Yes, exactly.
And he shut them out.
He did.
Well done, Duncan.
Queen's Park 0, Morton 0 in the battle of the teams who have been honking recently. So Morton still without a win since the start of the season, and they are still bottom of the table. Queen's Park stopped the rot a wee bit. It was four losses on the spin before that. And the big one at the top of the table was Raith Rovers versus Dundee United. Finished 1-1 at Starts Park. So it was Louis Moult who equalised for Dundee United after Lewis Vaughan had given them the lead a wee bit earlier on. Raith Rovers will be kicking themselves because you've got them at home, you're 1-0 in front with half an hour to go, and you're thinking, if we can hold on here, we'd be top of the table going into the international break. That's a... You know, Dundee United will be happier with that point than Raith Rovers.
But see, Dundee United have got this mentality now. They just never give up.
Dundee United have only conceded 4 goals this season. Yeah. And the teams, as we all know, that concede the fewest goals generally.
And Dundee United have got goals in their team. They're defending well. You can never count them out. So they pick up a point. Still good result for them. They're going to win the league. There's not even any point talking about the Championship. They're going to win the league. It's all about who's going to be finishing in the playoff position.
Who's going to win League One? Because it was Falkirk versus Hamilton on Saturday night.
Shite
and it
game.
Was probably only the second worst game of the weekend after the Arsenal Man City game yesterday, which I actually said, I don't think there's ever been a game that I've watched that's deserved a goal less than the Arsenal Man City game yesterday.
Yeah, it was something torture. It didn't deserve it. Yeah.
And the game on Saturday night, Falkirk Hamilton was tortured. Producer John was there. This was your big chance to put Hamilton to the sword. It's you two at the top of the table, both on 23 points now. But you should have beat them, John. Come on. John McGlynn bottling it again.
Not at all. It was two teams that went out there, basically cancelled each other out. No team wanted to lose that game. And that's really what happened. It wasn't a great game of football. Very few chances. But Falkirk still on top of the league and still unbeaten.
Okay.
I agree with them.
As are Hamilton.
I agree with them. I think both teams were...
No, because Hamilton aren't top of the league, Stephen.
All right. Right. They've got the same points.
I agree with John because I watched the second half of that game when I got back from Edinburgh, and I thought that both teams were scared to lose. That was the problem there.
Well, if I know one thing about John McGlynn's team, when it gets to the running, John, you're in for a great time because he handles the pressure really well. So we'll see what happens over the course of the season. Cove Rangers finally winning on Saturday, 3-2 against Annan. Edinburgh City 1, Kelty Hearts 4, Edinburgh City. They were dispensing with the services of Alan Maybury last week, so Mark Kerr was in charge, and they remain bottom of the table on 2 points, Kelty up into the playoff spots. And what is going on at Queen of the South and Marvin Bartley? Is he due to be on Super Scoreboard this week? I tell you what, 5 defeats in a row for Marvin Bartley. 1-0 they lost at home against Stirling Albion. They remain 7th in the table. Right, okay, so we've got a bit of unused budget on the Big Scottish Football Podcast. So we thought we would spend it on some star power for the show. So, now, unknown to a lot of American people, the American president, Joe Biden, is a huge fan of Scottish League 2 football. Okay, Ewan?
Uh-huh.
So, we thought we would bring him in to do our weekly coverage of League 2. Hello, Mr. President.
Thanks, you and Stephen. I'll make this quick as I am about to poop my pants. To games off as my favorite, the Warriors match was called off against Albion. Barnyard Rose tie with East Fife was also called off due to the weather. Damn that rain. Anyways, there was a barnstormer at Stair Park as the Spartans beat Stranraer 4-3. Blair Henderson eventually got the winner for the Spartans in an end-to-end match. Peterhead stayed top of the league after they beat those Bridey Lovers 4-3-1. And it was another loss for the Bully Wee after going unbeaten. Dumbarton pumped them for goals to nil. Oh no, I pooped my pants. God bless League Two. God bless America.
Thank you very much, Mr. President there. That's the most coherent I've heard them in a while, actually.
Can we have Joe Biden doing League Two every week from here on in?
Well, we'll certainly put in the request. So
that was good.
He was very fluent there. He's not usually
who came up with that idea?
I don't know. Let's do VRWTF, shall we, Producer John? Let's get on to that because there's lots and lots of refereeing decisions to get through.
La gente está muy loca. What the fuck?
Okay, you need to do the wee invisible triangle rectangle thing.
What do you mean?
Like you're doing the VAR
Do the rectangle thing.
Okay, right. Thank you very much. We can move on to that. Let's start with Celtic against Kilmarnock. It was Matthew McDermott who was the manager. Who was the referee, I should say, there. Was Hatate offside for the second goal? Because to me, he looked offside.
Yeah, but it's played off him.
Yes, but...
But it's played off him by the Kilmarnock player.
But the ball was meant for him. And I know... Like he was offside. The ball was meant for him. Stuart
Finn, wasn't meant for him. He was getting out the way. The ball wasn't going anywhere near him. It was going out to the wing.
Was it?
It was going out to the wing. And
but it did go to Hitati. But because it came off...
Because it came off... what's his name? The Kilmarnock defender.
Stuart Finlay.
Aye. He's kicked it and it's bounced into his direction.
I know, but he was still offside when the ball was kicked.
He's not kicked it.
No, but
Hatate's not kicked it. Hatate was trying to go out the way. You can see him running back. He's running back to get onside.
Hmm.
And then it's played off him by Stuart Finlay. So he's not offside.
Right, okay.
Read the laws of the game, mate. I'm an IFAB expert.
I'm not sure you are. Anyway,
I've just bloody told you.
And I'm not sure that's entirely the...
Let me explain it to you again. Hatate is in an offside position.
But Stuart Finlay wasn't meaning to... Like, Stuart Finlay just sort of like hit off him, did it not?
Wait a second.
But that's what I mean. Like, surely Stuart Finlay has to be in control of the ball.
He isn't in control. I'd agree with that.
So it's not off... So he should have been offside then?
Well, he's in control of the ball because he kicks it. He's not in control of it as in he's controlling it and dribbling.
But that's what I'm saying. I don't think Stuart Finlay didn't deliberately play it to Rio Tati. It just kind of hit off him.
But it's his touch.
I know, but that doesn't matter. It needs to be in control of the ball.
Right. Stephen.
Like, if Stuart Finlay got the ball and passed it back to the goalkeeper and, you know, like...
Hatate was standing there.
Yeah.
In front of the goalkeeper.
Yeah. Then that's not offside. But it hit off Finlay.
Well, he kind of kicks it off him.
Aye, but he's running. He's not... He just sort of sticks a leg out more than anything.
Yeah, so he's
not in control of the ball.
But then it's not Hatate's fault either.
I know it's not Hatate's fault.
But Hatate's trying to get out the way.
I don't know. I thought it was... Kind of, there was a grey area there, I thought.
Well, I've just told you. Right, it's a goal and it stands and it's not offside.
Was Greg Taylor fouled in the lead-up to Kilmarnock's goal?
No.
Okay. Let's move on to Hearts versus Hibs. Willie Collum, who gave out 3 yellow cards in the opening 15 minutes, and we all said in the studio, we were like, there's going to be a red card here, but it didn't actually happen. So should Hearts have had a penalty, there was David Marshall come running out.
Oh, yes. Nah.
Nah? Nah. No penalty for you?
Not having that.
Okay,
I loved it, but no, not having it.
Let's do St Mirren Rangers, because I was actually listening to it on the radio, right? Because I was dropping mum and dad off at the airport, and I was coming back, so the first like half an hour I only heard on the radio, and the commentators were like, oh, this looks really harsh, but we don't have monitors in front of us, so we've not seen it back.
But so how can you have an opinion on something when you've not seen it?
That's what I thought as well. And then obviously...
We're talking about the BBC here.
Yes. And then Strain gets sent off. And then when I got back to the house and I looked at it at halftime, I was like, what's he doing? Like, what a stupid thing to do.
It's Suarez in the 2010 World Cup.
Except it's against Rangers and it's 0-0 and there's still 70 minutes to go.
Yeah.
Like, it's as clear a handball... And sending off, as you will see.
But he knows that.
And I know.
Even the player knows it. The player knows it.
What a stupid thing. Like, if I was Stephen Robinson, and to be fair to Stephen Robinson, who was going mental at the time,
yeah.
He's obviously seen it back and then went, all right, because after the game, he was like, well, no complaints.
No complaints.
But, like, I'll give the BBC a wee bit benefit of the doubt because they didn't have the chance to see it back either. But the way they were speaking, I was like... God, is this a controversial decision? And it was in no way controversial because it was a handball and it was a red card.
He stopped the ball being tapped in by Seymour at the back post. He scooped it away. I mean, that's
so stupid.
It's a deliberate handball. Now, I think in a situation like that, now what Robinson will have said to him after the game is, look, why did you do that? We conceded the goal. At least we've got 11 players on the pitch.
Exactly.
And we've still got a game and a half.
Three quarters of a game, yeah. That's what you're trying to do. A half and then a half of a half is three quarters, yeah. No, you're totally right.
But do you know what I mean? Just concede the goal and then regroup and then try and get the equaliser.
Exactly.
As soon as you're down to 10 men against any team, but particularly a Glasgow team, Rangers or Celtic, you're going to be up against it. And it was only a matter of time before Rangers got that second. And I know what St Mirren were trying to do was they were trying to hold on to try and throw everything at them in the last 10 minutes. But once you're down to 10, you're never going to really do anything from that position.
So a good decision by VAR. And then Aberdeen St Johnstone. So Duke is ruled offside. Again, like I saw lots of Aberdeen fans, and Barry Robson was moaning about it afterwards, but I thought, like, even by the picture, he looked offside.
Aye.
I didn't think there was any sort of, like, debate around it, to be honest with you. There's also a check on a Graham Carey handball for St Johnstone as well, so we'll see what happens there. Elsewhere, I think the worst decision of the weekend was Lennon Miller getting sent off for Motherwell against Livingston. Now, he was sent off denying a goal-scoring opportunity. He was last man. I've looked at this three or four times. There's no contact that I can see, or if there is.
No, well, there is. It's minimum, though.
And it's certain.
There is contact. As he's throwing his leg back, because when you run, your leg goes back. The player's chasing him. No. I agree. I think it's not. I don't think it's a red card, right? It's 100%.
Well, no, if you're going to give a foul for that, you have to give a red card because he was right through and goal. But I thought the boy Dan McKay, I thought he sort of almost clicked his own heels.
He did because there's a wee touch from behind. It's like his studs had hit the back of the boy's shins.
I think that's really, 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 really harsh. I didn't think it was... There was a faintest touch.
Did the referee have a look at that again?
I mean, presumably he did. It was Don Robertson who was in charge. I just felt really sorry
for the
boy.
It changed the game.
Of course it did, yeah.
I agree with you. I think it was a really harsh red card.
Okay.
But by the letter of the law, it probably is. And again, because I'm an IFAB guy and I read about the IFAB stuff.
Of course you do.
I know I do. It's my bedtime reading.
Yeah.
Just so that I can educate you and the punters who listen or watch
this
show.
Cool. Just a wee reminder that this week, Clyde One Super Scoreboard on every night from 6 p.m. It's international week, and that means on Thursday night, it's Spain versus Scotland. Scotland can qualify in Spain on Thursday night. Gabs is over there for us. And Scott McTominay scoring a double for Manchester United on Saturday. So just getting nice warmed up for his double against Spain, hopefully on Thursday night. Clyde One Super Scoreboard will be doing an extended show from 6 o'clock all the way through to full time, and myself and Ewan and Steve Cowan will be on the rest of the country with the big Scotland football show from 7 p.m. so make sure you can check us out there. You can have the game on in the background and have us on, and we will keep you entertained all the way through.
I'm going to this game with no confidence after what happened to us against England.
I think we'll have learnt a wee bit from playing against
Spain
England.
Will be
chomping
at the bit to get revenge on us after what happened.
It's really unusual for you to be negative about Scotland.
No, don't you start that pish with me. I've been very positive about Scotland and our run and how well we've done with Norway,
and then we lose a friendly to a much better team and you've shat your pants.
No, I haven't shat my pants, but I just think that Spain have got something to prove, and I think they're going to go after us.
Well, of course they will, but I mean, we popped them at Hampden.
I'd take a 1-0 defeat right now. I don't want to get pumped.
I don't think we will get pumped.
Okay, good.
How many times have we been pumped?
Well, I thought we were pumped against England. I thought they hammered us on the night.
Yeah,
I mean, it was 3-1. It was a late 3-1. Third goal, but up to that point, they were a much better side.
Yeah.
And England are on the same level as Spain. So if England can do that at Hampden in front of our fans, what are Spain going to do to us?
Well, you could have said that before we played Spain. And
I did.
And what was the score that night?
We beat them 2-0.
Beat them 2-0. Right, okay, so... We'll see what happens.
Will lightning strike twice?
The Big Scottish Football Podcast with Stephen Mill and Ewan Cameron.
Right, okay.
What are we doing here?
We are doing putting something in the bin.
Oh, hi.
So.
What have I got?
Someone
your turn this week?
Really needs to take the bin out. I think probably the bin's getting full. So I think we're going to do this for another couple of weeks, and then the bin's coming to get emptied.
Yeah.
Okay.
Aye.
So plastic pitches. The question: who do you really support? Stadium burgers, double bookings, players who don't celebrate against their former teams, lunchtime kickoffs, and children taking signs to games, and Ewan's hats. And I notice you've stuck to the rules this week.
Yes, I have.
No hats this week. So last week's nomination of football glory hunters. Let's have some feedback. Although I completely understand families who are struggling financially in this economic minefield right now, taking their children to bigger games is potentially their only option. A great area, but for the general fan, 100% agree.
Yes, in theory, but surely you'd need more Glory Hunters if you want the club to get more tickets. The reason they didn't get more of an allocation is because they couldn't sell enough tickets last time round, so it sounds like they could have been doing with some more Ewan Camerons. Because you are a massive Glory Hunter, of course. Milne, 1989. Mainly these people that go about looking for Old Firm tickets when you don't hear a peep from them in any other game. I would point out that St Mirren yesterday, that was one of the lowest crowds of the season. And it was against Rangers.
That's interesting, eh? Could something to do with the weather?
Maybe it was on the telly. Maybe it was just because it was against Rangers. Maybe it was against... I don't think... Like, going to see... Like, I remember, like, you know, when I first started going to Dunfermline games, it felt like when Rangers and Celtic came to East End, it was a massive game.
Aye.
But there's just not that.
But you're unbeaten. You've got a chance to stretch your lead over Rangers.
Lunchtime kickoff on the telly.
Probably all that.
Yeah,
combination. So everything that we've chosen so far has gone in the Scottish football bin.
Yes, so our Glory Hunters are going to go in the bin. I need a drum roll, please, Producer John. With 86.2% of the vote, Glory Hunters are not going in the bin. No, of course they're going in the bin.
Yes! Thank you.
There you go. Right,
happy with that.
This week's nomination for going in the bin. Now, Ewan Cameron, I know you've got a couple of good ones.
Aye.
So I'm happy to...
Are you okay?
Defer to you.
Oh, great.
On this one.
Okay, so go with one or two because you picked number three last week.
Okay, I'll go for number one this week then. For going in the Scottish football bin. What have we got this week?
Hold on a wee second. I need to find it in my notes.
Remember, you can go to @BigFootballScott. You can follow us there on Twitter. You can get us on Instagram and Facebook as well. Just search for the Big Scottish Football Podcast and you'll get all the stuff that we get on Twitter as well.
Right. Which number did you go with?
Number one.
Right. In the Scottish football bin, I would like to put clubs changing their stadium names to brands.
So sponsored stadiums.
Sponsored stadiums like the Tony Macaroni Stadium.
Like the Etihad.
The Emirates Stadium. The Reebok Stadium. Those sorts of things.
Okay, so you're a traditionalist.
Yes, I am a traditionalist. I can't...
The Kilmac Stadium.
Yes.
Which is Dens Park. In old money.
Is that what that's called?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm sure it is. It's some stupid, like, the Kilmac so they're no, at is
it
not, Park.
I've always called it Dens Park.
Well, I mean, it is. I mean, it is Dens Park.
But it's always... not now. It's something else.
Sorry, it's actually the Scott Foam Stadium at Dens Park.
The what Foam Stadium?
The Scott Foam Stadium.
At Dens Park?
Yep, the Scott Foam Stadium.
I don't get that. And see if someone...
Well, surely you get it on financial grounds. That they're making money from it. That's the entire reason.
But you're stepping away from the tradition of the football club and its name and its history.
Let me tell you.
And
if somebody like Qatar Airways, for example, were like, you know what? We have a base at Edinburgh Airport. We have two daily flights to Doha. We want to get involved with the local football team. So we want to rename Tynecastle the Qatar Airways... Tynecastle Park.
I'm not having it.
And we'll give you £10 million a year.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah,
all right.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I mean. Yeah. Right, so branded football stadiums.
Football stadiums into Scottish football bin. I don't like it. I'm a traditionalist and I think that needs to stop.
Okay, right. Well, it's all up to you. You can vote on @BigFootballScott and we will bring you the results next week. And that bin must be about full to the brim at this moment in time. Right, let's call Jose. Shall we call
Jose? Jose.
Okay, right, let's give Jose a phone and see what he's been up to over the weekend. Here he goes. Hopefully, he's answered every week, actually.
I know. One week he won't answer.
Yeah.
Bit late today, to be honest.
We are later today.
He's probably having his lunch. What do you need someone for lunch? He's not going to answer. It's the first week he's no answering. Do we always speak to him before he goes to the gym or after the gym? It's before, isn't it?
Yeah.
So he might be at the gym.
He might be at the gym.
Leave him a voice note if it goes to voice note.
Well, don't get yourself into trouble like you did last week with the voice note.
Hi, it's Jose. Can you come on the phones right now? Leave me a message. Thank you.
Can't take your call right now. Just leave your message after the tone. When you're done, press hash or just hang up.
Jose, Even when you leave a voice note, you sound cool as fuck, my man. It's Ewan and Steven here from the Big Scottish Football Podcast. Just checking up on you, mate, to see how your weekend was.
Hope you're all right. Hope you had a decent weekend. Yes. We're assuming you're at the gym or you're otherwise engaged.
Otherwise engaged. Love you, my man.
So we'll hopefully speak to you next week. Aye. Thank you very much, Jose. Bye-bye.
Bye, Jose. Jose, 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 Jose,
Jose, Jose. That's sad.
Did I leave a voice note last week?
Yeah, you left a voice message for Mark Wilson.
Oh, loads of people got like their knickers in a twist about.
Yes, they did. Yes.
They did. I say loads. Two.
Yeah. So anyway, time for question time. No Fiona Bruce. She's away this week, so you'll just have to do it with us. It's the Big Scottish Football Question Time. And today, we're live in Wick. No, we're not. Off the back of Michael Beale getting pumped out the Rangers job last week, we asked the question simply, who was the worst Rangers manager out of our list? Now, Michael Beale, Pedro Caixinha and Paul Le Guin were on the list. Ewan Cameron added Mark Warburton. I wasn't going to have him on the list.
No, you didn't want him on the list, and I put him on the list, and that's gone down like a lead balloon.
It really has, because I was like, I thought he did a pretty decent job.
You did say that, and it turns out you were right, because the Rangers fans are raging that we put him on the list.
Exactly. A lot of people saying, where's Ali McCoist as well?
Was he that bad?
He didn't get Rangers promoted from the Championship.
When Motherwell pumped them. Was he manager that day?
No, he'd left before then.
Left before then.
Yeah, so I think, yeah. Ali McCoy's obviously very good Rangers striker, very bad Rangers manager. But anyway, out of this list, it was Michael Beale, Pedro Caixinha, Paul Le Guin, and as Ewan wanted, Mark Warburton. So let's go through some of the comments. 83, Boa Bobski. PLG, at least MB had a decent run when he first came in. Both had shocking transfer windows bringing in the old players, but PLG had better players at his disposal in the squad to begin with. Gogs Kerr says Ali McCoist has to be up there as well. Failed to win the Championship. Love the man, but still. Chris Bett says, an utter farce to have Warburton on this. Enjoy the show, lads, but you are both way off it here. No. I wasn't way off it. Ewan Cameron was. Warburton was the gaffer for the biggest Old Firm upset in history. That was the semi-final. Got us promoted in style. Scottish Cup final left us in second place.
Was that the Barry Mackay Thunderbolt?
It was, I think. Yeah. It went to penalties, was it not?
No, the Barry Mackay not scored something like from like 30 yards with his right foot in the top corner to take it to penalties.
I think possibly, yeah. But that's what I'm saying. It went to penalties. Cheryl says, feel bad because I pressed the wrong one. Now I can't undo. Sorry, Mark Warburton. In my defence, you shouldn't even be in this poll. Thanks, Cheryl, for grassing us in. Hello to Kyle, 53668. Pedro by a mile. You could hardly speak English. Got the player's name wrong. And when the dog stops barking, the caravan keeps rolling. Standing in the bushes, shouting at fans. Carlos Peña, Herrera, etc. Need I go on? I don't think you can have a go at someone for hardly speaking English.
No.
I mean, I don't know, Kyle, how your Portuguese is, to be honest with you. It's probably not great. So I wouldn't hold that against them. Hello to Robin of Cybernat. Ali McBeale was by far the worst. From his annoying Cockney accent to his complete lack of respect for other teams, the league has proven when he got pumped at home last weekend. Same when his team got pumped at Pittodrie earlier this year. The others had some decency. George Byrne says, I mean, Pedro made subs at halftime, leaving us with a back three of Halliday, Toral and O'Halloran. Only good thing he done was bring in Morelos, though he often picked Herrera to start over him. Similar to Beale, there were too many flops. Peña, Herrera, Bruno Alves and Dalcio. Damien, 99UK, it has to be Le Guin. It came in with a big reputation, failed to grasp Scottish football at all. Alan, A731, says Pedro's best game was him playing solitaire on the bench. So we put a poll up and the results are as followed. In reverse order, Mark Warburton, 1%.
Is that all he got?
Yes, that was Cheryl obviously pressing the wrong button. Mm-hmm. So Mark Warburton, 1%. Paul Le Guin only got 13% of the vote.
It's the worst Rangers manager.
Yes.
So he's third.
That means
it's between Caixinha and Beale.
So I can tell you that one of them got 42% and one of them got 44%. Who do you think was voted as the worst Rangers manager out of that list?
Beale. I'm going to go with Beale. It's been horrific.
Michael Beale got 42% of the vote. So the worst manager, according to this poll, was Pedro Caixinha with 44%. Wow. So there you are.
I mean, it's clear which two are the worst out of those four. Beale and Caixinha. Oof. I mean, they were shocking. I mean,
they really were. Okay, so big question for next week. Here it is. Which team, out with your biggest rivals, do you hate the most? which team out with your biggest rivals do you hate the most? So if you're Rangers, you can't pick Celtic. If you're Celtic, you can't pick Rangers. If you're Hearts, you can't pick Hibs, you can't pick vice versa.
Do you want me to answer that?
Yes.
As a Hearts fan, I'm going to... probably Aberdeen for me. It probably is Aberdeen. And that'll be the same for Rangers fans, I'm guessing. They'll probably go with Aberdeen out with the Celtic. Livingston, I can't stand.
Surely you have to go for Livingston.
That's what I'm saying. You've got an
anti-West Lothian agenda.
I don't have an anti-West Lothian agenda. I just don't like Livingston. I don't like their style of play or their plastic pitch. So I'm not the biggest fan of Aberdeen. I like the rivalry with Aberdeen. I do like that. There's always a wee rivalry between Hearts and Aberdeen. Do you know what? I'm going to go with Livingston.
Okay.
Is the club that I dislike the most out with of Hibs and Aberdeen.
Hate the most. Hate.
That's a strong word, hate.
You hate Livingston, though.
What's the definition?
That's the question.
What's the definition of hate?
The definition of hate is as follows.
Go and just Google that for me. What's the definition of hate? Because I think it's a really strong word.
Feel intense dislike for.
Yeah, Livingston.
glad we got there. I don't know who I'd pick, to be perfectly, because honestly, like, Falkirk are the biggest rivals. I don't hate Raith Rovers. Like, I'm really nonplussed by them.
So apart from Falkirk, do you not have any other club that you don't particularly like?
I went through a phase of really disliking St Mirren, and that was because...
Why?
Because we were always sort of going up against them for winning the championship and not getting relegated.
Right.
The year we got relegated under Stephen Kenny, St Mirren had been guff all season. So had we been. And then just as we started to get good, they got good as well. And then they stayed up on the second last day of the season after being 2-0 down against Motherwell. They ended up winning 3-2.
So St Mirren for you?
I don't hate St Mirren, though.
I said something on the football phoning, right, that got me a lot of heat. And I'm going to ask you this question. And John, who's producing it, I want you to jump in here as well. I've been a Hearts fan all my life. You've been a Dunfermline fan. You've been a Falkirk fan. I don't think that I will ever see in my lifetime Hearts reaching a European final. I don't think I'll ever see in my lifetime Hearts winning a league title. And that's the same for you as a Dunfermline fan and producer John as a Falkirk fan. So my question is, and there's a point that I made on the football forum when I was working with Alan Ruff, was I would like...
I think we need a jingle, John.
This is the Real Football Phone-In with Ewan Cameron and Alan Ruff. Call now on 0845 100 2101.
Would you like to experience what it's like to be a Celtic or Rangers fan going for a league title?
No.
Would you like to have that feeling?
No.
To know what it feels like?
No.
No.
To win a league title?
No.
When you're going to a European final, you don't want to have that feeling? Do you not want to experience that feeling? Because we're never going to have it.
But you get that feeling if you're going for the championship or if you're going for League One anyway.
We're talking about the best of the best here. We're talking about the Premier League title, the Premiership. We're talking about European nights, playing Liverpool, playing Man United. Don't you want to have those feelings?
No.
Don't you want to experience those feelings?
No.
I would. I'd love to feel what that feels like.
No. It's got no appeal. Because I know that if Dunfermline ever got into that situation, it would be...
I'm not saying that you support Rangers, I'm saying, but the feeling... what that's like inside.
Let me speak. If Dunfermline ever got into that situation where they were going for the top flight title or going on European runs, I know that that would be... There'd be something mental of had to have happened for that. Like, you know, we've been bought over by Billy Nair.
But it's never going to happen for you. That's what I'm saying. Would you like to be a woman for the day? Or would you like to be a man for the day? Or would you like to feel what it's like to be a dog? Or what would it be like?
Or what
would you like to be a dolphin and swim around the oceans, etc., etc.? And if you were to die and you come back as an animal, what would you like to be? Oh, I'd like to be a bird and fly about and all that.
I wouldn't. Because I get enough out of supporting Dunfermline that I don't need anything else. Because I know...
Shut up! I get enough out of Dunfermline, I don't need anything else. Would you not like to experience that feeling?
No.
I would like it would be nice to experience, not at the expense of sacrificing your club. You know
I'm
what
not
I mean?
Soccer. Well, you're saying you would you be like to be a Rangers or Celtic supporter?
No, I'm not saying that, you fanny. I'm not saying that.
No, well, what I'm saying is that if Dunfermline were to win the Scottish Cup, which in my lifetime could happen, right? You know,
it's not going to happen.
No, but, no, no. I accept it's unlikely. But Inverness have won a Scottish Cup in the last 10 years. St Johnstone have won two. You know, so if those clubs can, you know, get a run to the final and play whoever in the final. Wait, let me finish. I know that if Dunfermline were to win a Scottish Cup, it would mean more to me and more to my mates and more to everyone that supports Dunfermline than any of that shite. Right.
Spot on, Stephen, I think.
Right, yeah. I get that. And I totally understand the point that you're making. But you're clearly missing the point that I've made. Both of yous. Because you're small-minded, you're narrow-minded, and you've got an anti-Rangers, anti-Celtic agenda, and you can't see beyond your own little narrow-minded beliefs.
You're so wrong, Ewan.
All I've just said
you're
to you,
so
it's
wrong.
Like, I would love to imagine what it's like to be a rock star. I'd love that feeling for one day. Give me...
That's totally different.
Let me be...
You're comparing apples and oranges here.
No, I'm not.
Yeah, you are.
I'm not.
Now you're just winding it up to things I would like to do. Like, you know, that's effectively what you're doing.
No.
Things I would like to do. I'd like to win the lottery, Ewan. Like, you know, there's lots of things I would like to do, obviously. But you're narrowing it down to, would you want to know what it's feel like? Would you want to feel what it's like to be a Celtic or Rangers fan going for a title? Then no, I don't. Because otherwise I would just support Celtic. And no, but if I did want that, I would just support Celtic or Rangers.
See, I would love that feeling of winning Wimbledon. I'd love to have been Andy.
I know! Everybody wants to experience things
but
that
you
I'm doing.
But you don't want to experience being a Rangers or a Celtic fan. You want to be Andy Murray, you hold up the fucking trophy at Wimbledon.
But I can't just become Andy Murray and win Wimbledon. I could easily just become a Celtic or Rangers fan and have that feeling.
No, you couldn't, because you wouldn't have the same feeling because...
So it's a stupid question then?
No, it's one of those things that you have a debate around the table with your mum. No, it's not your mum.
It's a stupid debate and I've just absolutely roasted it there. So.
Sitting there with your mum, who do you want to be?
Yeah, exactly. Oh, yeah, exactly. Right, okay. Right.
But I thought about being a dog, mum.
Yeah. Do you know... I was actually thinking about this the other day. If you could go back and just watch something in like life that's in the world that's happened, right? So if you could just be a fly on the wall somewhere,
like Dallas, 1960, whatever it was.
If you could go back and you'd be on the grassy knoll, JFK went past, and you were there, and you could just be like, "Fucking hell!"
Aye,
like that's a debate.
Yeah,
what you've just said is just why don't you just become a Rangers or Celtic fan? That's effectively what you've just said. You've just called me and John small-minded and narrow-minded.
Yeah.
But for not just becoming Celtic or Rangers
But
fans.
You want to be a fly in the 60s watching JFK get shot.
I don't know, but I think that would be... Or
be a dug on a lead. Out there with...
You're the one who keeps mentioning becoming a dog. I've not mentioned that at all.
No, but that's fine and normal to think that you want to be a fly or you want to be a dog having a shit on the grass.
I said a fly in the wall. I said I was.
So you're not talking about being a literal fly.
No, I was just like just standing there.
So you want to be transported back to then and just watch it unfold.
I think that would be pretty cool. Right. Yeah.
So that's no different to saying, would you not want to feel what it's like to be a Celtic or Rangers fan winning a title? That's the same thing.
No, it's not.
No, bloody it's well, not.
It's not it's the same not. Thing. It's absolutely not.
Right, can we just move on?
Right, okay.
Yes, please do. Right, time for the quiz, the shootout quiz. It's the best part of the show. I'm winning. What's the score, John? You've got 6-1 here. It's definitely not 6-1.
It's 8-1.
8-1, yes, it's 8-1. So, wait a minute. I don't know if I've got a coin. Ewan.
Do you want to flip my pen?
No.
I don't know what you do with a pen. You flip it right.
Ewan lost the super scoreboard coin last week, by the way.
How did you lose it?
I have no idea. I think I took it home with me and I bought myself a
pen. How are you going to flip a pen, Stephen?
I don't know. I'm getting a pen to write with.
Right, I thought you were going to try to
flip a pen.
Would you like the ballpoint or the.
Wait, have you not got a coin in the studio?
No, you lost it. Right, hold on. I've got a coin in my pocket. I'll run through the studio.
No, you don't need to run through. You can flip it there.
All right, okay. That makes sense.
That's probably a good idea.
Right, who's heads and who's tails normally?
Well, you can decide.
Who, me?
Right, no, heads. John. Heads, you and tails. Stephen.
Go on.
And it is tails.
So, is that me?
Yeah, would you like to go first or second, Stephen?
I'll go second.
Go second. All right then. Okay, let's go with the quiz.
Okay, so it's a shootout quiz, just in case you don't know. We each take a question each in a penalty shootout style format. We can go for the top bin, which is worth 2 points. Ewan Cameron's up first. On you go.
Okay, Ewan, how are you?
I'm good, thanks, mate.
Excellent, no problem. Here we go. Would you rather be a dog or a dolphin? That's not the question. Right.
Very good.
Apart from Rangers, who are the only Scottish team to beat Celtic this season?
What? That doesn't make any sense. Rangers have not beat them.
Oh, I don't know why I've written Rangers. The question... Who are the only Scottish team to beat Celtic this season? That's you don't need apart from Rangers.
Because Rangers haven't beaten Celtic.
Yes, exactly.
This
so it's just who are the only Scottish
team? They've won 7 and drawn 1.
Yeah, but not just in the league.
Oh, come on, Nick.
Right, there you go. Boom. Off the fire.
Thank you. 1-0 me.
There you go. 1-0. Stephen, which Saudi Arabian club is Jack Henry at?
Oh, good question.
It's Al Etifak, the one that Steven Gerrard.
1-1.
Just rattling through these questions.
Stop.
Ewan!
Go.
And what year did Kieran Tierney join Arsenal?
If it's any consolation, Ewan, I know the answer. If that makes you feel better.
That's always makes him feel so much better.
I'll give you a clue. He left Celtic to go to Arsenal.
Did Rodgers sell him?
It was
Celtic.
Was it
Rodgers that sold him?
To Arsenal. No clues, please, John.
No, was it Rodgers that sold him? Because when was it in the season that Rodgers...
He came through the youth at Celtic, and that's where he sort of got his big break, and then he did really well, and then Arsenal signed him. That's what happened.
24 million, wasn't it?
But I guess...
I shut up.
The question is...
Stephen! I think that... Rodgers, was it the season? Was it Rodgers' last season that they sold Tierney? When was Rodgers' last season?
See, in quiz shows, when did it get to the point where all the contestants had to explain their answers? Yeah, it happens in every quiz show. It's really annoying, isn't it? Every quiz show now. Well, I think this, and Ewan's doing it here.
Yeah. You're not on the telly now, though, Ewan. I just need an answer to the question, please.
I am going to go for.
I'll give you the first
2000 and
I would have said
it's 18 or 19.
I'd have said
shut up, just shut up.
I'd have said 20 something as well. That's all.
It's 2000, same thing.
I know, but that's what I'm saying. I agree with you. Those would have been my first.
I'm going
two
18
numbers.
Or 19. I'm going to go. What year is it now? 23.
What's that got to do with it?
It's not been at fucking Arsenal for 5 years. I'm going 2019. Get in! Where did I get that from? That is something! Something! Maybe I was transported back. Maybe I was a fly on the wall somewhere. I don't know. But, get in! 2019, 2-1, get up, you prick.
It wasn't that difficult, Ewan.
2019, get
up. Who are you calling a prick?
Him!
Alright, okay.
Him, over there. You can try to put me
off. You don't call the quizmaster a prick.
No, you're the best!
Thank you. Right, Stephen.
Yeah.
Who wears the number 13 jersey for Rangers this season?
I know that.
Of course you do, Jambo Bear.
13 for Rangers.
Are you right doing what it is?
I see.
No.
I'm going to try and...
I thought you were going to fly through the answers.
I'm going to try and work out what you've written.
It's gone now. I thought you were saying, I'm going to flash around the answers, I'm going to take my time here.
If you are watching the YouTube version as well, Ewan has for some reason got a Lowry written down and then he's got lots of squiggles of squares and triangles. Yeah, I don't know why.
I know. You see that? Look. Lowry.
Was that his heat map?
No, I'm going to be perfectly honest with you here. I don't know.
Okay.
But I think the reason John will have asked me that is because there was all the stuff about Todd Cantwell last week, so I'll go for Todd Cantwell.
Look.
Can read you like a book, John. Can read you like a book.
I went Cantwell as well. I went Cantwell as well.
So you did, Ewan.
2-2.
2-2. Ewan.
Yeah.
Who was the last Scottish manager to win the Scottish Cup?
Oh,
The last Scottish manager to win the Scottish Cup.
Is there any consolation, you?
Sure.
I know who it is.
I see, I don't do this bull with you, right? I just write down what I think the answer is and I shut my mouth. I think there should be a rule in place.
What rule? The rule that you don't take a million years to answer a question.
The rule is that you shut your face when I get my question. Feel free to scribble and write down what you think it is, but don't be speaking in my ear because you just do my head in.
Right, I'll scribble.
So it's 2-2. Who's the last Scottish manager to win the Scottish Cup?
Who's that? Is
it Lennon, Rogers? McInnes.
How do you spell that again?
I'm going to go with
GF
Callum Davidson.
Goal!
Get in!
They're on fire today, Ewan.
3-3, 3-2.
Right, Stephen, you're up.
Yep.
Which SPFL team did Jim Goodwin start his managerial career with? Which SPFL team did Jim Goodwin start his managerial career with?
Alloa Athletic.
Oh, that sounds a bit right.
Because it is right, you. See, just get straight out with the answer. That's what we need.
3-3.
Okay, the next two questions, I'm going to give you a player. You're both going to get a player, and you've got to guess a player from the description. Okay, so name this player. I played at centre-half for Celtic after signing from AIK and won 49 caps for Sweden. I played centre-half at Celtic after signing from AIK and won 49 caps for Sweden. Ewan.
I don't know.
Valengra? No, was he Norwegian or was he Swedish? You got Mjallby as well. Yeah. Who's the Valet? Was it Valengra?
You all right? Valengra, a Norwegian team.
No, the boy that played for them. His first name, his second name began with V.
Vargas?
No, not Vargas. He's Swiss. No, this is a guy.
Vidar Reset.
No, Stephen.
I genuinely don't know what you're.
There's a boy that played under Martin O'Neill that had a V in his name.
Vargas.
No.
Is Valgaren.
Valharen. Was he Swedish or Norwegian? And you've also got Mjallby. It's one of those two. That's what I think, because those two are great defenders at Celtic, and O'Neill signed them both. It's either Valharen or Mjallby. Give me the question again.
Right.
Shut up, just tell me.
Right, okay. I've lost my page now. Right, Ewan, I played at centre half for Celtic after signing from AIK and won 49 caps for Sweden. Who is it?
Mjallby.
Final answer.
Get in. Oh, I so wanted just to say Yusval Haren.
Yusval Haren's Belgian.
Oh. Is he Belgian?
Yeah.
Is he?
He is.
Okay. Anyway, 4-3 to me.
Right, Stephen.
Yeah.
Same for you. I played in Scotland for Hearts after signing from Benfica and have 60 caps for Greece. Who am I?
I know who that is.
I signed for Hearts after signing from Benfica, 60 caps for Greece.
Takis Fisas, is it not?
What a player for Hearts.
Arguably, and he goes under the radar, Ewan, but I would say one of Hearts' greatest players.
He was phenomenal for us. Yep. I couldn't believe him. We signed him.
That's why I knew it straight away and just answered straight away.
Yep.
So wait, I've got a decision to make here.
You could go top bin, and you could go for force me to go for top bin. You could really put the pressure on for me here. It's really tempting to go to the top bin, I would say.
Why? I hate going first now for this situation.
Yeah.
I'm just going to go normal question to force him.
He's shattered. And then if you get this wrong, I've got a question to win.
Yeah, let's do it. Give me the fifth question.
Who were the last non-Old Firm team to win the League Cup? Who were the last non-Old Firm team to win the League Cup?
I'm not saying anything.
God.
I'm not going to say anything. But if it's any consolation, I know who it is. If you just think of the last team not Celtic or Rangers to win the League Cup, then you'll get it. If you just think about it.
Is there somebody after St Johnstone? Is there somebody after St Johnstone? That's
the question that's in my head
big
right now.
Big question, isn't it?
They won the league, they won the cup double that year. Is there somebody that won it after them? Do you need the name of the team or you just need me to say it's
of
not
of course
St.
I
John's
need the name of the team.
Oh, I'm going to kick myself here. The League Cup, not the Scottish Cup.
League Cup.
Is that, it's not Aberdeen, is it? Oh my god, this question's killing me. And I wish I'd gone top in. Can I change my mind?
Nope. No.
Do you actually know who it is?
Yeah.
Do you?
It's so obvious.
Can he be giving me another Callum Davidson St. Johnstone question? I think he's trying to trick me here. But that's the only one I've got in my head right now. But I think there's somebody else.
Just think of teams that have won the Scottish League Cup who aren't Celtic or Rangers, and that will lead you to the answer. It's so obvious. I can't believe.
Shut up, Stephen!
Can't believe you're taking this long over.
I'm going to have to just go away. I'm going to have to just go away. It's not Inverness, is it? Is it Inverness? I'm going to go. Is it Inverness? Why have I got them in my head? John,
don't talk to him, John.
John, just breathe two times in my ear when I say the name.
Just answer the question.
Ah, St. Johnstone.
St. John's final answer.
Yeah. Oh my God! Why was I doubting myself?
I don't know. That's what I was saying. I was like, it's so obvious. Oh,
right.
Oh my God! I'm 5-4
it's
up.
It's down to this.
Oh, it's 5-4 up. Oh, to go 8-2. Come on, the fight back will be on. Come
right.
on.
Right. Hibs, double winning hero, not winning, but double drawing hero at the weekend. Johan joined Hibs after playing from which club? That's actually quite a tough
one. Are you taking the fucking piss? He gets, who's the last non-Old Firm team to win the League Cup? And you've given me, who is Johan signed from? Are you taking the piss?
I think this could be.
Can I go for a top bin question? I've probably got a chance with that.
No. This is going to be 8-2.
No.
You didn't give me the chance.
No, shut up.
You didn't give me the chance. You didn't ask me the question whether I wanted to go top bin. I want to go top bin.
You went
straight in with the question. You never asked me. I was considering top bin.
You were not considering top bin.
I want to get top bin.
There is absolutely no way you would have went top bin.
No.
John,
you just need to. Did you ask me the question or not?
I did not ask you.
Thank you very much. Ask me the question now.
What?
Ask me the question now, because I need to be asked the question. You know, I've been wronged here.
No.
I've been wronged here.
Why would you go top?
Because I want to just win it and get it done.
No.
I want to just win it and get it done.
No. John, you need to make a ruling here.
What do you mean? You, the ruling is I haven't been asked whether I wanted top bin. You got asked whether you wanted the top bin, and I didn't. How's that fair?
Listen, if he wants a top bin question, give it to him. Either way, I'm going to win this, right? Because he won't get the top bin question right.
Give me the top bin question.
Give me the top bin question, and then we'll let the punters who listen on the podcast and who watch us on YouTube to ultimately decide if he gets this
okay.
right. Because I think he's cheated me here, but let's just play his game. Let's just play it with his rules. Because it's like a fucking kid with a toy. It's his toy or nobody's toy.
Right.
Top bin. Give it to
top bin.
How many current Premiership teams has Jose Quitongo played for?
Okay.
If you get this right, I'm walking out. I'm walking out with my bag.
It won't be worth it.
I'm walking out with my bag, and I'm not staying for the outro or anything. I'm walking out.
I'm just going to get my bag ready for stuff. He's giggling away there as if he knows the answer, and I'm not going to fucking put up with it. I'm ready to go. My bag's out. I'm walking out. I'm telling you, I'm not even going to say churro to you. I'm just going to walk straight there. I'm going to get my car and I'm going to piss off. So I'm ready to go. Go and give him your answer, you prick.
No, I need to think about it.
Think about my arse. You've already got the answer, I'm telling you.
This could be historical, Ewan.
Historical.
Well, I know he played with Hamilton, but they're not in the top flight. I know he played with... who else did he play with? There's one team that I'm swithering over. I think the answer's one or two. But I can't decide whether it's one or two.
I'm leaving if you get this right.
Rage quit the podcast.
Oh.
Yeah, and I'll be walking past your studio to slap you, John.
HR, hello.
Right, so we definitely played with Hearts.
Yes.
Shut you!
Come on, Ewan, for God's sake!
Just don't
we speak
say
to him
anything.
Every week.
Don't
he
say...
talks about Hearts every week. He played in the Masters right. for Hearts two just, weeks ago.
I'm walking out. Just you hurry up and say your answer.
My dilemma is I don't know whether he played with Livingston or not. He either played with Livingston or he didn't. And I think that's the only... I don't think he played with anyone else. Didn't play with Rangers, didn't play with Celtic, didn't play with Hibs, didn't play with Aberdeen, didn't play with Dundee, didn't play with Ross County, didn't play with St Mirren, didn't play with Kilmarnock. Right. Two.
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 Final answer.
Final answer.
And Marshall has saved! Yes!
Well done! Yes! I can't believe it! Jose Quitongo played for Hearts, Kilmarnock, Livingston and St Mirren. That is a win for Ewan. Ewan, you can celebrate. Like, there you go.
Oh, well,
listen to that music. That,
I mean, it's been a while since I've heard the music. It is an absolute joy. Wow, what a relief. I had to end his winning run, and today was a day that I've obliterated him. Obliterated
hardly.
Him.
Hardly? Who did Johan play for?
Wait. I got 5 out of 5 today.
Who did Johan play for?
St
Gallen! How was I ever meant to get
that? I have been studying all week.
Shut up.
Everything around Scottish football. It's 8-2. The fight
Bring
back,
back
is
Chris.
On.
These
the,
questions are pish.
The fight back is on. 8-2. Thank you. Me
Hit
and my
outro
bag
music, John. We're out here.
Go.
Okay. Clyde One Super Scoreboard and the Big Scotland Football Show have coverage of Spain versus Scotland this Thursday night. Make sure you join us wherever you are listening in the country, of course. And this has been the Big Scottish Football Podcast. Thank you very much for watching on YouTube and for listening wherever you listen to your podcast.
You.
Remember, always subscribe and give us a big fat juicy 5 stars as well. Remember, our Billy Davies special is out later on this week. It's going to ruffle a few feathers. Make sure you tune in for that as well. You'll see that on YouTube and, of course, all your usual podcast providers. So let's end with a nice thing. Apart from it being nice to have a laugh at Scottish football, it's also brilliant hearing Ewan, the weapon, getting wound up. That is from XGIY46. Anyway, there we go. Nice way to end. Bye-bye. We're back next
time. And I'm a champion!